Good evening. It's a real pleasure to be here. I've been in Australia a few times, but it's my first visit to Melbourne. And not being in Melbourne is a real omission, because at Monash University and here at Swinburne, you have some of the leading groups in the field, in my field of ultra-cold atoms. So it's a wonderful opportunity for me to visit those groups, and today I had a really interesting day here at Swinburne talking to various researchers. So when I give a public lecture, I assume most of you are non-physicists. So let me ask you, who is non-physicist? Wonderful, the lecture is for you. And to all the other physicists, probably I won't tell you anything new. But anyway, I often introduce public lectures by saying physics, the description of the physical world, is a cultural achievement. If I look at what equations and physical pictures we draw from our observations of nature, they are very beautiful. So for me, science and physics is a cultural achievement comparable to cultural achievements in music and literature. So in that sense, what I want to do tonight for you is I want to play a piece of physics for you. So just sit back, relax, and enjoy. On the other hand, I'm also a physics professor and I want to teach you something. So I hope you will walk away after this lecture with some knowledge of what is the frontier of science, what is the exciting physics which is just happening a few years ago or happening now. And at the same time, I also want to familiarize you with some physical concepts like, what does it mean to go down to absolute zero to produce the coldest matter in the universe? But maybe most importantly, I think what I hope you get the impression that science is really exciting and science is lively, and for those who are talented to do science, and I see a number of students in the audience, go for it. You have a really good life if you are a scientist. So, let me introduce low temperatures by raising the question, do you have any idea how fast atoms and molecules are at room temperature? Who knows the answer? Well, is it, maybe now I'm teasing you a little bit, but your skin gets bombarded by millions and millions of air molecules, and you have no idea how fast they are? Are they at, you know, a bicycle speed, at the speed of a bullet, or the speed of an airplane? Yeah. Yes, the speed of an airplane. And I said, I'm a physics teacher, and maybe I want to teach you something you should never forget. So you should never forget for the rest of your life, and that's all I want to accomplish in my lecture, that molecules, I hope for more, but if that's the only thing you remember, I'm already happy, that air molecules at normal temperature are as fast as a jet airplane. And there is a physical reason for it. The jet airplane moves at the speed of sound or slightly below, because going supersonic would cause a number of problems in fuel economy and environmental impact. So airplanes go at the speed of sound. But molecules also go at the speed of sound, because you can only hear my voice because the molecules are moving. And the speed of sound is the velocity of the molecules in this room. Anyway, but these are very hot molecules, and let's just wonder, why would you like to have very, very slow atoms or molecules? Cold atoms, atoms which are not moving anymore at the speed of a jet airplane, which are just moving at snail's pace, almost come to a standstill. What would cold atoms be good for? Yes? They are easier to observe, yes. And why do we want to observe atoms? Well, we want to do measurements on them. And one important measurement we do on atoms is we use them as an atomic clock. What ticks inside an atom, there are electrons and spins, there is motion inside an atom. And when we observe this motion, this is much more accurate than any other clock. But if the atoms move at the speed of a jet airplane, they zip through the apparatus in 10,000ths of a second, and we can only look at them for a very, very short time. But now, and I will tell you how we do that, when we have atoms which move 1,000 times slower means 1,000,000 times lower temperature, then we have much more time to observe them, and as a result, the accuracy of today's atomic clocks using ultra-cold atoms is 1,000 times more precise. And there are other very precise measurements you can do. I don't want to go into details here, but there are atom interferometers which are used for gravity measurements and navigation. And actually, at ANU here in Australia, you have one of the leading groups in atom interferometry. Okay, so we know already what happens to atoms at low temperature. They slow down, and they slow down a lot from, I hope you remember it, the speed of a jet airplane to an extremely low velocity. So we are talking in our laboratory, we are creating atoms which are so cold, if I would release them in this room, by the end of the lecture, they would not have reached the walls of this room. So this is very interesting, but it's not necessarily new science. It's just cool, it's just colder, it's everything in slow motion. But what is really special is that once the temperature gets lower and lower, there is a phase transition, a very special phase transition. And you're all familiar with phase transitions when water freezes and becomes ice. Suddenly, the properties of the material becomes very, very different. And if you don't believe that it's different, I mean, just jump into a frozen swimming pool and you notice the difference. So this is what a phase transition is. And here the phase transition is that the atoms literally march in lockstep. So this is a cartoon picture how you can think about atoms and molecules. And actually, if you think physicists just think in equation, no. I have all those pictures in my mind. This really shapes my intuition and makes me creative in finding out new things in nature. So I think about atoms as just moving around randomly. I mean, this happens here in this gas. But at very low temperature, close to absolute zero, suddenly the atoms march in lockstep. There is a new form of matter which emerges called the Bose-Einstein condensate. Now, this cartoon picture shows a lot of what happens in the physical system. You have the random motion of those guys. They are colorful, have different colors. For the physicists, they are in different quantum states. They all have the same color. They are only in one quantum state. But what is not correct here, you cannot really distinguish them anymore because they are just one quantum mechanical wave. It is one orbital, one wave function. That's how you should describe this form of matter. So I started out, and this is really maybe even more dramatic, it has been much more dramatic than it sounds, that we started out as atomic physicists. We wanted to improve the precision of measurements, slow down the motion of atoms to a more accurate atomic clock, and improve, let's say, the global positioning system or communication. But we achieved that. But what we also found is a new material with new properties. And I think there is no need to tell you that new materials are exciting, because if we find new materials, we can change the world. And this has been an ongoing story in the development of technology, that all the advanced electronics we have is really based on new materials. Our iPhones, our computers only work because of new materials. And now, by simply bringing down the temperature of atoms, we are not just improving the accuracy of measurements, we found a new material. And so what I want to show you in the first part of my talk is I want to show you how special this new material is, very, very cold, close to absolute zero. I want to show you that it's really made of waves, that it has quantum mechanical properties, not just being a particle, but also being a wave. And eventually, I want to show you that this material is superfluid. But before I show you those properties of the material, I want to say a few words about it. How do we make it? How do we reach those low temperature? Now, I could give 2 lectures on all the tricks we are playing to cool atoms down to very low temperature. Let me just talk about one of the cooling techniques, laser cooling, because it still sometimes blows my mind that it is possible to shine laser light on atoms. And what you think what would happen, well, what happens? If you shine a powerful laser on your hand, do you feel heat or do you feel coldness? Heat. You can, well, if I go to one of the labs and I'm not careful, I can burn my skin with one of the powerful lasers. So this is what normally happens because the laser beam has a lot of energy. But atoms are special. Atoms cannot absorb the light. Once they have absorbed a photon, they have to re-emit it. So atoms, light in, light out, they cannot transform the light into heat. And once we have this neutral balance between light in and light out, small differences can make a big difference. And And what happens here is, if we arrange for a situation that the emitted light is a little bit more energetic than the absorbed light, and that means the emitted light has a little bit higher frequency than the absorbed light, then every time an atom absorbs and emits a photon, it radiates away a little bit of extra energy, and in this process, the atom cools down. And if you think it's very complicated, how can an atom change the frequency of light? One simple way how it happens is the Doppler effect. An atom is in motion, and if something is in motion, the frequency of light in the forward and backward direction is slightly shifted. And just this effect is enough to shine light on atoms and eventually get very cold atoms. So let me give you an idea how things look in the laboratory. The atoms are over here in a vacuum chamber, but the vacuum chamber is surrounded by, well, it looks like a physicist's dungeon, or it's surrounded by optics, by cables, and don't even ask the question if every piece here is adjusted. Yes, if you would move one of the pieces, the experiment would not work. But you also realize, the picture shows, what is the most important part in research, and these are the students. All this research is done with, you know, the energy and the ambition of young students who, you know, join a research group. Within months or a year, they learn about the research field, and at the end of, let's say, a PhD, they're one of the world experts on the subject of their research. So here is another example of actually one of those cold atom labs here in Melbourne at Monash University. Here you see a close-up of a vacuum chamber, so all the action, which I will tell you, happens behind this window. Behind this window is vacuum, and right there, this is where the atoms are. And I mentioned already, for the cooling of the atoms, we need laser light. We also need laser light for other purposes, and I will tell you about it. But that means if you walk in one of those labs, there is a laser light show. And I mean, I still, after 20 years, I can walk into a laboratory and enjoy the elegance of a laser beam which bounces back and forth between optics, goes through lenses, and eventually enters the vacuum chamber and interacts with the atoms inside. And what you see here is a situation where we have many different colors of laser light. Yellow is the color of sodium. You see sodium in the yellow street lamps. Red is the color of lithium, and green is, well, like my laser pointer, it's used for special purposes. So here we did an experiment where all three colors of light were needed simultaneously. And here you see a picture of ultra-cold atoms. So we have some sodium vapor inside, we have multiple laser beams, and then with the principle I outlined to you before, we create these laser-cooled atoms. So this fuzzy ball of sodium atoms, you can just look at them with the naked eye. The size is a few millimeter. These are atoms which are cooled to millikelvin or slightly below. Just to give you the scale, this is 1,000 times colder than interstellar space. Just to give you the relation, I use the Kelvin scale, which directly measures the energy of a gas. So if you go from room temperature, 300 Kelvin, to interstellar space, 2.8 Kelvin, it gets colder by a factor of 100. What you see here is colder by a factor of 1,000. But now I want to tell you what happens when we go to nanokelvin, which is another factor of 100,000 colder. So we are a billion times colder than interstellar space in some of our experiments. So I don't want to give you more details about the experiment because they don't really matter. I rather want to show you the beauty of the scientific results and how beautiful it is to look at quantum mechanics in action. But let me sort of give you just a cartoon picture that you can imagine how those experiments are done. So first, we have a vacuum chamber which is needed to isolate the cold atoms from the room temperature environment of our laboratory. And now the cloud of atoms, and I will show you pictures of them, is a tiny little amount of gas. The size of the cloud is 50-100 micrometer. It's the scale of the diameter of the human hair. It's a little bit of gas, but enough to do all those experiments. And these atoms, they have to be in a container, which makes sure they're not flying away. But the special thing about our container, it's not a material container, because the atoms would just stick to the walls of this container and wouldn't be a gas of atoms anymore. So our container consists of electric and magnetic fields. You can sort of imagine the atom is magnetic like a little compass needle, and when the atom moves away, there is a magnetic field which reflects it. So the atom, which is itself magnetic, bounces back and forth between magnetic walls. And the advantage, of course, is the atom cannot stick to those walls. Those walls don't need to be cooled down. They are invisible electric or magnetic fields. So eventually, we can't touch the atoms to figure out what happens. Again, we use laser light. So for instance, if we shine a laser beam on the atoms scatter light. Then with a digital camera, we can get a picture. And what you see here is an elongated cloud of atoms. And I said the scale here is the scale of the diameter of the human hair. It's also very important that we cannot just look at the cloud as it is. We can also measure the momentum or the velocity of the atoms. When we switch off the electric or magnetic field, which form the walls of the container for the atoms, we call that an atom trap. Now the atoms are free. They will simply, the atoms will simply spread out, and if we then snap a picture, here it's a shadow picture because the atoms scatter light and this is the shadow of the atoms, we find out what the velocity is. So in other words, we let the cloud expand for given time, and then after a certain time, this size of the atoms is proportional to the velocity. Okay, so what I want to show you now in the next few pictures is what happens when we cool down the gas. So we have hot atoms, we bombard them with laser light, we do some evaporative cooling, some other cooling method which gets us close to absolute zero. Then we let the cloud expand and we look at the shadow picture. Those atoms are now moving further away. They hit the walls of our vacuum chamber and our vacuum pumps take care of them. They have done their job. But then 10 or 20 or 30 seconds later, we take the next bunch of atoms, but this time we cool them down to a little bit lower temperature. How would you expect the shadow of those atoms to look like? If the atoms are colder, what happens to the shadow picture? A little bit smaller, because the atoms have a smaller velocity. So therefore, what I want to show you on the next slide is, I want to show you a rendering of data, where successively we went to lower and lower and lower temperature, and as a result, you will see how the shadow shrinks. We are very cold. We are here more than a million times colder than interstellar space, and you see how the shadow shrinks. But it's not just shrinking. Watch out. Something happens. It suddenly looks like a cherry, and there is a pit inside. We call it a bimodal distribution. There was something, I play it again for you. There was something fuzzy around it, and this fuzzy thing, which is, I tell you what it is in a moment, thermal atoms in motion, they get colder and colder. But suddenly, we reach the phase transition where this new form of matter forms, and you clearly see how it forms inside. So these atoms are very, very cold because the shadow is so small, so they don't spread out at all. So that means we are really close to absolute zero. This is how we measure how cold the atoms are. Now, there was a sudden change also in the shape of the shadow. I hope you saw it, that the shadow was first circular, but then this new form of matter was elliptical. And I want to tell you why. But this means for us there is a phase transition. The material has changed its properties. And just to give you a short explanation, what has happened is the following. I didn't really tell you that our magnetic box is elongated. It's just much easier with magnetic fields to create an elongated box than to create a round box. But for normal gas at high temperature of a few microkelvin, which is high for us, the atoms are in random motion. And if they expand, they will expand in all directions, no matter what the shape of the container is. So therefore, no matter what the shape of the container is, you see a round cloud if the gas is in random motion. So the fact that the shadow suddenly is elliptical means no longer random motion. I could say that means the atoms march in lockstep. You can't really see it from this picture. I will later tell you how. But the explanation is that the atoms now behave as a wave. And if the container is elliptical, the wave is elliptical. And this is what you're seeing here. So I just showed you a picture of the Bose-Einstein condensate, and I want to point out that there are, you know, three places here in Australia, Swinburne and Monash, and also at ANU in Canberra, where this kind of research is done. So if you have an opportunity to visit one of those labs, maybe you can take a lab tour and see sort of the place where the coldest matter in the universe is produced. Okay, I gave you at least an idea how do we cool the atoms down. I explained laser cooling to you, and then we cool further by evaporative cooling. I showed you how we observe that that these atoms are very, very cold. They hardly expand at all. But now I want to show you that they have very special properties. They are made of waves, and they are superfluid. So how do we show in physics that particles march in lockstep? Actually, marching in lockstep is just an analogy, or is a way to describe that the atoms are all coherent. They behave as one single wave. So showing that they march in lockstep means that they behave like a wave. Now, how do you show that something behaves like a wave? Let me illustrate that example. We usually use, if you want to show that something has wave-like properties, we use the principle of interference. But let me explain that. If you would throw a paintball on a white wall, and you would see a spot of red paint, and you use a second paintball, then what you would find out is the absence of interference. Paint and paint just gives darker paint. But now use a laser beam, a red laser beam, and do the same experiment. What you find out is where the two laser beams interfere, you will see a pattern of darkness and brightness, darkness and brightness. Because the electric field of the electromagnetic wave, the electric field of the laser beam, has the following property, that a positive electric field and a negative electric field can add up to zero, and that is responsible for the darkness. So in other words, for waves, we have the equation that light and light can result in darkness. Now, you can do the same with water waves. If you go to the bay and throw two stones into the water, you create two spherical waves. And here in between, where the two waves interfere, they form what we call a standing wave. But the standing wave has nodes, and at the nodes, the water surface is not moving. So again, you see the feature of waves, that motion and motion, depending if positive and positive or positive and negative velocity can up, motion and motion can give stronger motion, but motion and motion can also add up to a standstill. So this is the principle. So now I think you got the idea. Two laser beams, two stones, we need two Bose-Einstein condensates. So I've already shown you how we make a Bose-Einstein condensate, and now, and this is the reason why in some of our experiments we use green light, we just take our green laser beam and cut the Bose-Einstein condensate into two pieces. So here we have our two Bose-Einstein condensates. And what I want to show you now is the result of the experiment where we have two Bose-Einstein condensate. We switch off all the laser beams, all the electric and magnetic field, and then they fall down, but they also expand because the atoms slightly repel each other, and now they interfere. And the question is, will those atoms, it's not light, it's a material, it's atoms, will they now behave like paint, or will they behave like waves? And this is a picture we saw. So you see it's a little bit of noise outside, but this is where the light is. And here you see the shadow of the atoms. But the shadow has stripes, darkness, bright, dark and bright. And where you see the bright region, that's where the light just goes through, and it goes through because there are no atoms. Therefore, there is no shadow. So this pattern here is the direct evidence that the Bose-Einstein condensate behaves as one single wave. And just to sort of make it dramatic, here, where the light comes through, there is no shadow. Therefore, there are no atoms. So what happens there is that atoms and atoms add up to nothing, to vacuum. But that's just the property of waves. So when the Nobel Prize was awarded to the discovery and early experiments with Bose-Einstein condensation in 2001, the Nobel Committee highlighted the new technique to go to Bose-Einstein condensation, the discovery of this form of matter, which had been predicted 70 years ago, but only observed in the laboratory in 1995. And then they also highlighted this experiment, which really showed the nature of the Bose-Einstein condensate. So when you go to Stockholm and receive the Nobel Prize, it's a fantastic party. You have dinner with the king and queen, you have a chauffeur for the week, you receive a gold medal. But what is also very, very special, your Nobel diploma is a piece of art. An artist has drawn my research. And what it shows is a Bose-Einstein condensate cut with a laser beam into two pieces. And those atoms are quantum mechanical objects. They are at the same time particles, little bullets, but they are also waves indicated by this wave-like pattern. And what happens here when the two Bose-Einstein condensates come together? This is sort of the artistic rendering of the last slide I've shown to you. Okay, so this is how we have shown that this new form of matter behaves like one quantum mechanical wave. And actually, the analogy goes much deeper. It shows that those atoms actually behave to some extent like laser light. The Bose-Einstein condensate is for atoms what the laser is for light. A very special coherent form of light or coherent form of atoms. So let me now move on and talk about superfluidity. When I said the atoms march in lockstep, there's an important implication. And just use the analogy with people. If you go to a shopping mall and there are many, many people and they bump into each other, there is a lot of friction and dissipation. But if the people march in lockstep, they can quickly move out, they can move along without bumping into each other. So when particles, atoms or electrons march in lockstep, this is actually synonymous with there is no dissipation, there is no bumping into each other, and this is actually behind the mechanism for superfluidity and superconductors. Superconductors have enormous technical potential, and the Bose-Einstein condensate is the simplest case where the principle of a superconductor is realized, namely the marching in lockstep. So therefore, superfluidity is important for fundamental concepts, but also for practical applications. So now I want to show you that this gas of atoms is superfluid. Now, when you want to show that something is superfluid, you want to show that it moves like a wave. And now, if you have a tiny cloud of atoms, it's hard for us to move it through our apparatus. I mean, I've shown you the vacuum chamber, here's the gas cloud. We rather want to put it, leave it where it is. But what we can do is we can set it in rotation. So now I want to give you the proof that this gas is superfluid by showing to you when these atoms move, they have to move like waves. They have to move in a way which is characteristic for superfluid. So in other words, what I want to tell you is if you would have a bucket full of a liquid, and maybe this is a normal liquid, you know what happens. You rotate the bucket, and if you rotate the bucket for a while, the water is just rotating with the bucket like a rigid body. The water has the same angular velocity as the bucket, and the only thing you see from the rotation is this kind of meniscus due to centrifugal forces. But if we have a superfluid, it cannot rotate like a normal fluid, and it will actually rotate by forming these vortices, and this is what I want to explain to you. So let's assume we have a superfluid which goes in a circle. As I said, we should really think about the superfluid as being one wave. And I've shown you with this interference pattern that yes, indeed, we should. The physical nature of these ultra-cold atoms is that they behave like a wave. So there's now one little thing of quantum mechanics I should explain to you. Each particle can be described as a wave, but when the particle is faster, the wavelength is shorter. When the particle is slower, the wavelength is longer. And I think this is probably the only equation I have in my talk. It's a de Broglie relation that this wavelength is inversely proportional to the velocity. So what does it now mean when particles go in a circle? Well, it means when the particles go in a circle, the wave has to close on itself. This is sort of in quantum mechanics how we describe orbitals, how we describe motion. The wave has to sort of be continuous. So therefore, a superfluid or wave can only move according to the condition that what you have to have is an integer number of wavelengths per circumference. Then the wave starts and ends at the same point. So this is the physics of waves rotating. But if we need an integer number of waves, I've given here you some examples per circumference, that means it is absolutely impossible to move like a rigid body. The water in the bucket has a velocity which linearly increased with radius. This is what a rigid body in rotation does. But a superfluid, because it consists of waves, there have to be jumps in the velocity because you have to jump from one wavelength per circumference to two wavelengths to three wavelengths. So there have to be jumps to fulfill this condition that the wave has to close in itself. So therefore, if we would look at the velocity field of a rotating superfluid, there have to be some jumps to fulfill what is the condition for wave-like motion. So what I've shown here is that the velocity would jump from one value, would smoothly vary, jump to the next, and jump to the next. Now this would be possible. This would in principle be possible for waves, but if you look at it a little bit more carefully, the result is that instead of having jumps of the velocity here, you create actually jumps, singularities, which are not rings, but there are points here. So this is now the velocity field of waves, and it fulfills in a slightly more complicated way what I explained to you, that you always have an integer number of waves per circumference. So this is how the liquid in the superfluid in the rotating bucket would look like, and each of those points is actually like the eye of a tornado. The velocity field is exactly the velocity field around a tornado, but these are classical tornadoes on a large scale or on a smaller scale, but we see now the same velocity field in the quantum world. So if you want to show now that our Bose-Einstein condensate, the superfluid, is superfluid, has the superfluid motion of waves, we have to set this cloud in rotation. You're already familiar with those shadow pictures. This is a shadow picture of now a very nice and round Bose-Einstein condensate. We use a different kind of trap, so here we've really made a round container. And now we set it in motion. And we set it in motion, again, using our magic green laser beam. If you now move a laser beam around the atoms, it's a little bit like if you take a feather and move it around a ping pong ball. You can set the ping pong ball in rotation. And now, if we allow the cloud to expand and look at the picture, this is what we see. So this is a cloud, but where the light comes through, there are no atoms. So you should think now it's a cloud which has many, many tunnels drilled into the cloud. This is a dilute gas, it's a gas. But it's very, very cold, and what you see here are the properties of a quantum mechanical object which behaves as a wave. So, for us physicists, this is really special because it shows the laws of quantum mechanics, not at a microscopic scale. We all know inside an atom, inside a molecule, we need a quantum mechanical description. But this here is quantum mechanics on a millimeter scale, on a large scale object. So maybe after the talk, if you come home, you can tell your friends or your spouses or your children, this guy has really shown us something weird. He showed a gas, and the gas looked like a zebra, or the gas looked like Swiss cheese. But this is how wave physics profoundly changed how the gas behaves. I hope I've shown you that we have a new material which has really very, very special properties because it's cold, because it behaves as a wave. I've mainly shown you so far what we knew about those very cold atoms within the first few years after the discovery. But now I want to give you an idea what is currently happening in our labs, where this research has been taken. As Professor Weil was mentioning, the discovery of Bose-Einstein condensation received the Nobel Prize in 2001. But now, 16 years later, the field is full of excitement. There are many places in Australia, in Europe, all over the world who do research on cold atoms. And I want to give you now an idea why. Why after the discovery we don't say, okay, check mark, we have discovered the Bose-Einstein condensate, let's move on to something else. What the Bose-Einstein condensate meant for us, that we are now have very exquisite control of atoms. We can really bring atoms to a standstill, and even more so, we can control them at the level of quantum mechanics. We really control the wave part, or for the physicist, we prepare atoms in a single quantum state. So this now means we have atoms like Lego pieces. And now, using other laser beams, we can take those laser Lego pieces, rearrange them. So in other words, the Bose-Einstein condensate is now a form of matter, and we can twist the atoms around and create new forms of matter, or even discover forms of matter which have not even been predicted. So therefore, this ultra-low temperature and these Bose-Einstein condensates have become a platform to look for new materials or obtain a deeper understanding for materials which already exist. So this idea to use now ultra-cold atoms as Lego pieces and assemble them in search for new materials. Some people call it now a quantum simulator because we use atoms to simulate or create other materials. And this is, in that sense, a special purpose quantum computer. I don't want to say much more about it. I rather want to show you how do we take the atoms and how do we assemble them. But first, I want to give you more the idea, why are we doing it? Why are we creating new materials of those ultra-cold atoms? So, to say it up front, we are creating new materials, but those new materials just exist in a vacuum chamber. So you can't really take them out, build a device, or immediately do something useful for them. But by using this extreme low temperature, we can obtain deeper insight into nature, understand materials, and an understanding of materials forms the basis of new science and technology in the future. So what I want to explain to you now, what is really special about these new forms of matter which we create, and why can we learn a lot from them? So I mentioned already that those materials are very, very cold, nanokelvin, and I've shown you that if we drop these atoms, they are not flying apart. They almost drop like a rock because the thermal velocity has been reduced to almost zero. But they have another property which is important and which I didn't emphasize so more. I showed you all those pictures of the atoms, and of course, you have no idea looking at this picture how dense those atoms are. What you saw in those pictures with this Bose-Einstein condensate, in this shadow picture, you typically saw a million atoms. You think a million, well, if you have $1 million, a million is a big number. A million atom is also a big number if you just want to look at the atoms and study them. But normal matter has a million times a million times a million atom inside. So compared to ordinary matter, we have almost no atoms at all. And now to relate it to density, our Bose-Einstein condensate or our cold atom clouds are at those densities, and this density is 1 million times more dilute than air. So if you think air is dilute, you can't really grab it, divide it by a million, and then you get an idea how dense our system is. It's absolutely dilute, it's extremely dilute. But this is very important because if people study materials, and people study materials at all levels, the normal material, like you know, any liquid, any material you can touch, consists of atoms which are pressed against each other. This is the normal density of materials. But that means the building blocks, when they are pressed against each other, are completely modified. The atoms in a piece of matter do not have the properties of isolated atoms because electrons are shared, there is chemical bonding, there is band structure, there are conduction bands. So the properties of this material are hard to predict by just knowing what is the composition of the material. People have made enormous progress, but it's still a challenge to simply know, hey, there's a material made of such and such atoms and then predict the properties. However, our materials, which we form out of ultra-cold atoms, are extremely dilute. Atoms have a size of less than a nanometer, and we have, I can't even stretch my hands far enough, we have 100 nanometer in between them. That means we can still control those Lego pieces with all the methods of atomic physics, because they are almost all of the time isolated atoms. Occasionally, they may connect or bounce into each other, but most of the time they are atoms which can be accurately controlled. And all the forces between atoms which are responsible for the material properties, we know them also with very, very high precision, because by maybe looking at two atoms in form of a molecule, we can very precisely measure what is the weak electric field which exerts the force from one atom onto the other. So what we have here is we have built materials out of building blocks which we exactly understand. So therefore, the equations which describe this form of matter are much simpler than the equations which people have to solve to describe what you may call real solids and real materials. So, in other words, we can now create materials which are simpler, which are more idealized. And let me use that now to introduce you in a way how physicists or actually scientists or actually many people usually attack a complicated problem. If assume you are a scientist and you want to describe a new material, but the new material is really complicated and you have to set up equations. You would first start with something simple. You make a lot of idealization. An idealization which many people make in theoretical physics is they assume that electrons are non-interacting. And they first describe what goes on in a material as if the electrons don't interact. Then they put in interactions. Then they put in impurities. So you build up step by step complexity. And ideally, you want to test your model, you want to test your description at every single step. And testing usually means compare with experiments. But have you ever seen non-interacting electrons? Electrons are charged. They always repel each other. But with our atoms, because we understand atoms and we have tools, we can actually make atoms non-interact. They're no longer colliding. Or we can make them interact strongly, so they really run into each other and bounce back. So we have all this control about Lego pieces that what we can do is we can follow the theory steps by step. So this just shows how theorists work. If you would ask a theorist to describe a cow, the theorist would start by, let's assume the cow is spherical, because then you can describe the cow with only one coordinate, the radius, instead of x, y, and z. So sometimes physicists use the spherical cow approximation for materials, but there are, of course, it's hard to do experiments with spherical cows. So let me give an analogy, summarizing what I just told you. Often, if you want to design something new, or if you want to discover new materials, I just use the analogy of an airplane, you have a big goal, which is really complex. And you need really equations, you need a design to make sure that you understand what you are doing. But it is often necessary, if you have a complex description, to have a model and do some testing, for instance, here in a wind tunnel. So what happens is you have a design, you have a model, you test the model, you improve the design, and after a few iterations, maybe you are ready now to design the real airplane. And let me compare that in our quest to find new materials. The world has limitless opportunities to create new materials, but we need guidance, we need an understanding of those materials. And it is really almost impossible to have an adequate description how those materials work. So what is needed is you have to sort of make toy models, increase the complexity, and those theories can now be tested by comparison with experiments with ultra-cold atoms. So the ultra-cold atoms sort of act as a wind tunnel for a simplified description of materials, which is necessary as a stepping stone for further advances. Okay, this is what is actually currently driving the research, cold atoms as a tool to understand materials more deeply. So anyway, this was a little bit abstract, but I felt I should really tell you what is now the current research and how does the field move from a discovery to something which becomes a research tool, and in this case, a tool to understand new materials. Anyway, after this more abstract summary, I want to now show you how we can now take those Lego pieces and assemble them. And then in the last few minutes, I want to tell you about one of the latest discoveries we've made. So anyway, you know already how our experiments are performed. We have these atoms held together by electric and magnetic field. But now what we want to do is we want to send additional laser beams on it, maybe radio waves and microwaves. And these laser beams and radio waves and microwaves transform a Bose-Einstein condensate into something new. And let me give you one example, and this is of course inspired by nature. Many materials are crystalline. And I can just step back and look, isn't nature beautiful? Nature has, you know, so much beauty. It organizes atoms in these periodic crystals. And of course, what we sometimes we say something is beautiful because it's not perfect. It has sort of irregularities. It's much more interesting to look at something which is not perfect. But as I mentioned to you, we are interested in the basic understanding what is going on, and we want to create more idealized model. And often when we want to understand what happens in a crystal, we try to create a much simpler version. So we are not trying to simulate quartz. Once we understand a simple crystal and what is going on, then we have pretty much, we are close to even understanding what happens when you have irregularities. So let me now raise the question, how can we create something like this using cold atoms? Or in other words, how can we create a periodic potential that the atoms are lined up in this regular crystalline form? Well, we have to use laser light, and let me show you the principle here. If you want to align sand in a regular pattern, you can actually do that by, this is a famous experiment which is done for students, you shake a plate, you shake it with a sound wave, and now the sand arranges itself, it follows the pattern of the wave, and actually what happens is you create sound waves on this plate, and the sand goes to the nodes of the standing wave, where the plate is in standstill. So in other words, the sand is attracted to the nodes of the wave. And here it's another wave pattern, quite beautiful. Let's now transform this idea that particles are attracted to the nodes of waves, let's apply it to atoms. Atoms are attracted by electric fields. So if we now interfere to laser beams, they form a standing wave, we have a pattern of high and low, high and low, high and low electric fields, and the atoms will now arrange themselves in this regular array because the atoms are, I said it already before, are attracted by the electric field, actually in the same way how iron powder is attracted by magnetic fields. Okay, so we can use two laser beams and create a standing pattern. If we now use four laser beams, two standing waves orthogonal to each other, they actually form a pattern of electric field which looks like this egg carton. So the atoms now see a pattern of high and low electric field, and they are attracted. It now really depends what color of light we use, whether they are attracted by the high and low electric field, but the atoms really see potential which looks like this egg carton. And what happens is if you would put atoms into this intersection of four laser beams, the atoms would arrange themselves like those eggs in a regular pattern. And by using another two laser beams in X and in Y and in Z, now we have six laser beams, we can actually generalize it to three dimensions. So here is a picture done by colleagues at Harvard. They have a microscope and they can now see single atoms. Each green dot is a single atom. And if you look at this pattern, you really see that the atoms are lined up on lines. They are really have arranged itself in this kind of egg carton. But this egg carton consists of electric fields. Now, this is pretty boring because the atoms have a lot of room. But what is different from, I will show you what happens when we put sort of more atoms into it. But let me first show you that you would say, well, if you use the analogy with eggs, why do you buy expensive lasers and do those experiments? Why don't you just play with eggs? Well, there's a big difference. The eggs, if you put them, they stay put. But the atoms are quantum mechanical objects. They are waves and they can tunnel. So the atoms can pretty much go through the wall from one side of the egg carton to the next. So what will happen is, so if you prepare atoms in this egg carton, and these are just, it's a row of single atoms, and we allow them now to spread out in this direction, they will just spread out. And it looks like they spread out by randomly going left and right. But this is not classical. This is a wave. So what you should think about it, that you have an atom, and the atomic wave is spreading out. All these atoms spread out identically. It's only when we switch on the light and look at the atom that we do the quantum mechanical measurement process, and this atom which is spread out is randomly observed here or here or here. And what you see here is a few snapshots out of the random distribution. But now I want to show you what happens when we look at longer times, and this shows that the atoms really behave like waves. So what you see here is what happens as a function of time. The atoms are just spreading out. But then if you wait, almost magically, they come back to the place they started. What happens is the atoms have to be described as waves, and waves sort of oscillate, and after a certain time, all the waves constructively interfere that the atoms have to come back to this position. So what I just showed you would never happen to eggs, would never happen to classical objects. This is how atoms behave in this kind of electric fields and potential. Well, it gets much more interesting if you put in more atoms. So you would say if you have one atom per side, well, your egg carton is full. And indeed, if the atoms strongly repel each other, this is now an insulator. It's a system like an electrical insulator where the electrons can no longer move. However, when the atoms are only weakly repelling each other, I told you, we have our knobs, we can adjust the forces between atoms, then, and this would be again hard with eggs, you have sometimes empty sides, and sometimes you have two or three atoms on a side. So they can now move around. And actually, in this experiment, people have observed that atoms can move around as a superfluid, like a Bose-Einstein condensate, or they can become an insulator. So by simply changing the forces between the atoms, we can now see another phase transition. I've already shown you this phase transition from randomly moving atoms to Bose-Einstein condensate when we lowered the temperature. This here is a phase transition which happens at zero temperature. It's called a quantum phase transition from a superfluid to an insulator. And you would say, well, yeah, that's a nice play with eggs or inspired by eggs. This is exactly the physics we want to do because we want to fully understand what happens in a phase transition. And this phase transition is just challenging enough that we have to work hard to have a complete description of it. And just to illustrate that this is really special and advances our understanding, I estimate that about 1,000 research papers have been written about this phenomenon to deeply understand it and have an exact mathematical description. So I want to show you that we can use cold atoms and find new materials. There are three materials where we simply cool down the atoms and see what happens. One is the Bose-Einstein condensate, the simple superfluid. I just described to you a very special system where the atoms are in these optical lattices and they can either be superfluid and a mod insulator. And if I had a little bit more time, I would have described a third simple form of matter. But if you're really interested, paired fermions are studied here at Swinburne University, and probably somebody else can tell you about it. I want to rather use the last few minutes to just give you an idea about a new discovery we have made, which is called a super solid. And I can sort of tease you, and it really tells you something about modern materials. It's a form of matter which defies almost everything you've learned in high school. It's a form of matter which is a gas, a liquid, and a solid all at the same time. Now, it's sort of a special form of matter, and if you create something like this, well, you get some weird press reports about your research. But yeah, it's really, I mean, it's exciting, it's exotic, it's weird at the same time, but it is something which helps us to understand materials and eventually advanced material science. So let me just give you a cartoon picture why this form of matter is special. I've already described the Bose-Einstein condensate and the superfluid to you, that it's sort of, it consists of one waves, and it's really particles which have merged. Many, many particles just behave as one wave. If you have something which is solid, like a crystalline form of material, it's made of identical atoms, but each atom is localized. Each atom sort of has its place. And so you see these are completely different principles. Here each atom is individual, and here all the atoms form one ensemble. So now the question is, how can we combine the property of a solid with the property of a superfluid? And it wasn't even clear for a long time in physics whether this would be possible. Well, I have to now really define for you what is the essential feature of a solid. What is really the difference between a solid and a gas or liquid? The solid has shape, the solid has a form, whereas a gas or liquid just fills the container. So therefore, we could create a superfluid and a solid at the same time by having a superfluid which had a shape, which had a form. And the simplest form we realized was a periodic pattern, a periodic density modulation. So this is how we realized the supersolid. Now I show you two or three more slides. They're maybe a little bit more advanced. Probably the physicists will understand it, but also for the non-physicists, you may get an idea how we modify materials. So we have a Bose-Einstein condensate here, and I said, okay, now we can modify its behavior with extra laser beams. And those laser beams flip an internal state, we call it spin, go from sort of a red condensate, from a blue condensate to a red condensate, but at the same time, they also kick the atoms from zero velocity to finite velocity. And this is done by a two-photon transition. We need two laser beams for that. So if we have now a red and a blue condensate and we kick them with this spin orbit coupling, which is done by these two laser beams, this is sort of what we have. A red condensate, a blue condensate at zero velocity, and then those little daughter condensates at finite velocity. But now what happens is what I already explained to you. When we have two wave-like objects at different velocities, they interfere, they form a spatial pattern. I showed you this zebra-like pattern. This was interference. It was interference of moving atoms, and here it is interference of actually stationary atoms, and it is this pattern which turned our superfluid Bose-Einstein condensate in a supersolid. Anyway, I can't really explain it fully to most of you, but this was sort of the idea. So anyway, let me summarize. Research on cold atoms, which is now going on everywhere in the world, has as a major goal the quest for new materials. So we can test our understanding and develop our understanding of materials by building models, models on these enlarged scales where the atoms are kept very far away. I said what we are doing is, it is physics at the quantum level. We are doing quantum simulations of material, and just to flash a few buzzwords, the concepts and the techniques we are using are related to what is used in quantum computers, what is eventually used in quantum devices, I mentioned already precision measurements and quantum technology, metrology. We are really entering a new era now where we're talking about quantum technology, those new materials, those methods at the quantum level are now really ready also for applications, for some technological applications. In the world of materials, we're not running out of ideas. The main subject of my talk was superfluid materials, but in our labs, we are also working on magnetic properties of materials, and both in our work and also for this Australian Fleet Center, what is the main focus is matter with a special twist, matter with topological properties, which are very, very special, but this would be the subject of another lecture. So I thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer your questions.
Can I take you back to the point in your lecture where you were talking about your spherical cow, or you've concluded with that? You're talking about the very dilute atoms there, and the not making those initial assumptions of non-interaction of the electrons. What you're showing there with the red and blue dots seem to indicate a possibly salt like sodium chloride, in other words, ions rather than atoms. So the question arises when you're saying assuming non-interaction of those electrons,
yes.
What's the material and what is the bonding between that material normally if it wasn't dilute, and how does that play a role?
These are all These are excellent questions. So in some sense, what we are creating is the spherical cow of materials. We are interested in, let's say, a phenomenon in a material, and we try to find a simple implementation where a theoretical description is still possible. So what we are doing now is we want to describe the motion of electrons in a material. But what we do is, we can't control electrons at that level, but we can control neutral atoms. So we now allow neutral atoms to move around, and we create a situation where the motion of neutral atoms has certain features which we try to understand with electrons, but now we can study the spherical cow version of that. So what we can do is, in contrast to electrons, electrons always interact with electric forces. For the neutral atoms, we can turn a knob. We can switch off the interactions, which is easy for theory. We can have weak interactions where theory can still follow. And then we can have strong interactions, and suddenly the theorists throw up their hands and say, this is really difficult. But this is what the theorists have to do in order to describe the electrons. So you see, sort of, we can start with a spherical cow, and then we can slowly change the shape of the cow. Hopefully the theorists can follow us, or we can still understand what happens in an elliptical cow, and eventually we go to the real cow. This is sort of the approach. But you may be surprised, but with neutral atoms, we can really capture very important properties of, let's say, electrons. Also, the electrons are charged. And just to give you an example, what happens in a superconductor where electrons move as a wave may be difficult to understand, but we can understand some aspects by looking at a Bose-Einstein condensate which behaves like a wave. And if you ask, what does a Bose-Einstein condensate have to do with electrons, so different systems, there is an aspect about what really makes a superfluid behave as a superfluid, and this aspect can be fully understood with neutral atoms, and this understanding can then be carried over and is a stepping stone towards understanding the more complicated system. This is how science works. It's maybe complicated, but if you think about it, it's very natural. You want to do controlled steps and validate each step of your understanding.
How does the phase change from having many particles to one wave occur? And also, wouldn't that violate the Pauli exclusion principle, where you having many different particles just become one wave?
Okay, these were two questions. How does the phase change happen? Well, I showed it to you. You remember those shadow pictures, and it happens actually, it's a second order phase transition, which means it happens gradually. The cloud was shrinking, and then you saw that something happened in the inside. First, you couldn't see it, but then these atoms which march in lockstep, this cloud was increasing. So in other words, if you take this colorful cartoon, the phase change happens that, the phase change really happens in that way, that first all the atoms move randomly, but then there is first one, then two, then three atoms, which are like the blue guys. So first one, first two, first three atoms march in lockstep, and more come. So as we turn down the temperature, we see that this blue group of particles is slowly increasing. So it's a gradual change, and one atom at a time is added into the lockstep of the other people. You can really imagine, you know, you're in a crowded place, some people say, hey, let's march in lockstep, and then one person after the next joins. This is really how the phase transition happens. And if you are asking whether it violates the Pauli exclusion principle, no, it doesn't, because I showed you the experiment. It doesn't violate, it really happens. But just to explain it to you, what happens is the following. The atoms are bosonic atoms which do not fall under the Pauli exclusion principle. You would say, well, that's cheating, because what is inside the atoms are electrons, and for electrons we have the Pauli exclusion principle. But what happens is we are not asking the electrons to march in lockstep, we are only asking the atoms, which is a composite object, to march in lockstep. The electrons still behave according to the Pauli exclusion principle, and since we have so much space between the atoms, there is enough space for them to fulfill, enough momentum space actually, because they move rapidly, to fulfill the Pauli exclusion principle. Or to say it, it's a little bit more technical, but what happens is an atom consists of proton, neutrons, electrons, many, many fermions. They all have to obey the Pauli exclusion principle. But the wave-like motion I described and demonstrated for you is only the center of mass motion of all those fermions. The fermions do not form a wave. The wave-like property is observed when we look at the center of mass motion of the whole atom. So that's sort of how the connection is.
There's a question there.
I'm going to represent the non-physicist crowd, so one for them. The materials, as we understand today, is mostly because of its interactions, its excitations. For example, you said laser experiments. You demonstrated various laser colors. That's because of the properties of the material in certain excitation states. They exhibit certain characters, like colors emitted by certain atoms.
Yes.
The wavelength they are in. Now, by removing all the interactions, supercooling them, making them into a lockstep, we are removing all the known properties of them that we knew about certain materials. Now we are trying to use that as a building block to find new materials. Are we going to start knowing about these materials all from scratch? So sodium atoms supercooled, it's not a sodium atom anymore. Is that fair to assume?
No, actually, the sodium atom, when it's supercooled, is still a sodium atom. It's not losing its property. It's just that one sodium atom and the other sodium atom march in lockstep. But the sodium atoms also, they have formed one wave. They are so dilute that this cloud of sodium atoms, it is so big, and the sodium atoms are so small that they are not touching each other. So therefore, they have still all the properties of an individual sodium atom. We can use radio waves, we can use lasers, and the atoms in a Bose-Einstein condensate have exactly the same resonance as an isolated atom. This is actually very important, because we can now use the tools of atomic physics, resonance, resonant laser light, radio waves, to manipulate, to modify this form of matter, or to say it in a non-technical way, we can only play with the Lego pieces because they are still atoms. We know their properties and we know how to push atoms around, how to hold on to atoms, how to flip the spin in atoms. So it's really important that those atoms have all the atomic properties we know very, very well.
Yes. If the atoms are a half integral spin, why do they add one at a time instead of in pairs to not compose Einstein condensate, which is in integral spin?
You're asking about the spin of the atoms. When I talked about the super solid and I mentioned the word spin, the spin is actually, the spin of the atoms is an integer spin, but what was depicted in red and blue, it's more a pseudo spin, it's more a label. The real spin of the atoms is spin one, so therefore, or integer, so therefore the atoms are bosons and they can be both condensed.
So the atoms that you add to this condensate, this step condensate, are always of integral spin?
The atoms which undergo Bose-Einstein condensation are, we call them bosons, and they have an integer spin. Fermions would behave differently.
But the ones that you're adding to that boson, you're saying that you have atoms that you keep adding to the boson as Einstein condensate. You keep adding them and adding them. And you said you can do it one by one. So you're saying that those particular atoms would have integral spin?
Yes, absolutely. Integer spin, yeah.
I think it's just the third or fourth.
Just the experiment. When you evacuate the chamber and introduce the gas, then you switch on the lasers, what sort of time does it take for the condensate to appear? Is it seconds, hours, or days, or?
It's actually surprising. You think if you want to make something so cold, if you put something in a refrigerator, how long does it take until it's cold? But the atoms, they are bombarded with laser beams, and I showed how laser cooling works. It just takes a small fraction of a second to cool them down to pretty low temperature, and then the final stage cooling, depending which lab, takes between 10 seconds and a minute. So we press start on a button. We have a flap which opens, hot vapor comes out, laser beams switch on automatically, magnetic field switches on. And 20 seconds later, we have a Bose-Einstein condensate. That's how it works. So it's very satisfying. If you're a student, you can press a button, and 20 seconds later, you see a Bose-Einstein condensate. It's amazing.
Question, Dan.
Is there a reason why you chose sodium?
Is there a reason why we choose sodium? Yes, of course. All chemical elements, with one exception in the periodic table, have a bosonic isotope. And we pick the atoms based on technology. We want to pick atoms which can be manipulated, which have a resonance for visible or infrared lasers. If you pick an atom which requires lasers deep in the UV, it's much, much harder to develop those lasers. So it's mainly for technical reasons that we pick the atom. Also, if you pick alkali atoms, rubidium, sodium, you just heat a metal up to a few hundred degrees and you get a vapor. If you work with chromium or other metals, you have to heat them up to more than 1,000 degrees before you create a vapor. So if you want to set up an experiment, which one do you choose? You choose the one which can be, for which you can create this Bose-Einstein condensate with the smallest amount of technology and with the simplest apparatus possible. The apparatus is already complicated enough, even if you pick the simplest atom.
Okay, we probably have time for one or two last questions. Yep, one at the back.
Yep, just a small question for you. You mentioned it during the last slide that some of these quantum technologies are ready to come out of the lab and to be sort of like real-world applications. As a person who's in like at the forefront of technology, would you mind sort of giving a few examples of what we can expect out of these technologies? If you can give a couple of examples.
The question is about quantum technologies. Well, I don't want to overstate the point. But quantum metrology, quantum cryptography means we can now use the properties of quantum mechanics to encode messages with a code which cannot be broken. A quantum mechanical code, if you use quantum entanglement to encrypt the message, it's impossible to break it. So there is one interest. I mentioned with quantum metrology that the current precision of atomic clocks is based on quantum physics. So where we see technology emerging is in the field of cryptography, communication, which is absolutely safe, where eavesdropping is not possible. We see quantum technologies emerge at the level of very precise measurement. More precise atomic clocks can be used for mapping out geology, mapping out the Earth's gravitational field. And if you have the atomic clocks, it's amazing. Just in the last few years became so precise, you move an atomic clock, and if you are above oil, the atomic clock may start ticking a little bit faster or slower because the gravitational field of the Earth has changed. So these are technologies which now emerge. As you see from my description, it's not technologies which you will find in your home or in your living room or in your car. These are sort of advanced technologies, but they are interesting enough that we are now observing that some companies like Google and Microsoft and IBM are actually investing into those technologies. I don't want to promise that there will be a major technological breakthrough in just a few years, but people are It's getting interesting enough that there are special programs, collaborations between universities and industry. For instance, another one is quantum computer. Until we have a practical quantum computer, it will take a long time. But some people think we are close enough to have a quantum computer, which is good for very, very special problems. You know, not surfing the net or sending email messages. But if you want to do certain optimizations, we may, in a few years, be at the point that certain problems can be better solved with a quantum computer. This is a very special quantum computer. It requires a whole lab and whatever to run, but it's getting interesting. It's becoming no longer just science, it's becoming technology. So in other words, I'm not promising there will be, if you invest in quantum technology, you will, you know, get rich in a few years because the stock market is exploding. No, I mean, this is not happening. But we see now the beginnings where knowledge and science of today is already emerging as a technology and companies are interested in picking it up. And this is actually also one reason why we have the Australian government is funding the Fleet Center, Future Low Energy Electronic Technologies, not in building a device, but we are close enough that a push in fundamental research can really lead to new materials. It's still probably 10, 20 years, but we are seeing the transition now. We are, more and more people talk about how can this quantum physics be applied.
On the subject of future technologies, do you see photonic computing moving information with light rather than electrons as having much of a future at this point?
The question is the optical computer, instead of having computer chips where electrons move around, it would be a computer chips where laser beams are guided. People have worked on that already a long time and it didn't really take off. It's much, much harder to get the complexity of computer chips with millions of transistors integrated. So I think light will never, this is my personal expectation, and maybe, you know, the future proves me wrong, but I don't expect that we will see a transition from electronic chips to optical chips. We are talking about, I mean, people in research labs have small scale, you can say, optical transistors, which are elements of an optical computer, but in the field of integrated optics, you want to solve some very specific problems where light is really superior. I don't think that light will ever replace electrons for general purpose computation.
And the final question here. Have these kind of experiments also been done on fermions? And if so, Are there similar transitions?
Yes. So, just one second. Let me just flash one slide as an illustration. So give me 1 minute, since many people mentioned fermions. I didn't have time to explain it, but what maybe to reconcile a few questions, I should explain that all particles in the world, you and me, the water bottle, an atom, a molecule, can be classified into 2 different classes of materials. And the classification goes in the low energy physics world of everyday life or of our experiments, any object consists of protons, neutrons, and electrons. These are the basic building blocks of nature. You have to go to very high energies and use accelerators, then you can break a proton down into quarks and you name it. But at ordinary energies, building blocks are protons, neutrons, and electrons. And now you can classify all objects in the world, whether they contain an even or an odd number of constituents. And it's easy to see there is no third possibility. It's either even or odd. And the even constituent particle we call bosons. And everything I told you today was about bosons, about atoms which have an even number of electrons, protons, and neutrons. If you take an odd number of protons, electrons, or neutrons, we call it a fermion. And fermions do not, as the name says, do not do Bose-Einstein condensation. They behave very differently. But still, you can have a Bose-Einstein condensate of fermions. And this is sort of what I left, oops, what I said yesterday's lecture. When I said C. Swinburne University, this is when I related. I said, I don't have time, you know, talk to Chris Whale, who is studying fermions. If you have fermion pairs, odd and odd gives even. So fermions cannot be both condensed by themselves. They first have to find a partner, and then they can form a Bose-Einstein condensate. And yes, indeed, this was very exciting. Experiments have been actually done by pairing fermionic atoms. For instance, the lithium-6 isotope of lithium has 3 protons, 3 neutrons, and 3 electrons. Even, an odd number, it's a fermion. And if you want to both condense lithium, don't even try it, lithium-6. You have to pair 2 lithium atoms first together, and then you can both condense them. And this is a wonderful model for what electrons do in a superconductor. Electrons are fermions, 1 electron, odd. But when 2 electrons form a pair, then they can form a Bose-Einstein condensate, and this is the simplest explanation how a superconductor works. But anyway, I'm starting a second lecture now, so I think, Chris, we should close the event.
Yeah. So please join me in the second lecture.